aquariums are everywhere, from dentist's office to right in your house. It's clear to see that aquariums are ever popular. And with a constant increase in the aquarium hobby, beginner aquarists are popping up everywhere. However, whilst browsing articles and looking in forums, I have seen an increase in numbers of not just beginners, but even experienced fish keepers making mistakes. This video will inform everyone about some unexpected mistakes that everyone can make. Now, these aren't just going to be the already common ones that many, many people know, like don't overfeed, but more so the ones that I have encountered during my time. Before I start, I would like to point out that this has not been made to have a jab at anyone, but more so to inform you, as I can attest to making these mistakes more than a few times. Feel free to ask me any questions or correct me when I'm wrong. I've just made this video to help people who were once like me. First up is temperature. This is something that I didn't fully realise until I dove into the breeding aspect of the hobby. When people say, oh, that's a tropical fish, or that's a warm water fish, many people with experience will know that the consensus for a temperature of that kind of water is 24 to 30 degrees Celsius, and that all tropical fish generally fall under this branch, when in fact fish such as discus, or more common example of cherry shrimp, are kept in warm water conditions. They can stay alive and eat, but when you increase the temperature, you may notice behaviour never displayed before, such as vibrant colours, increased movement, and regular and more yielding spawns. I've discovered that when trying to breed my red and blue cherry shrimp, I kept noticing that the shrimplets developed not only slower and grew smaller than others, but that they also didn't have enough babies. However, when I set the tank to around 28 degrees Celsius, I noticed these said behavioural changes. When researching for fish, many people want to make a community tank and a place that fish in it can share the same tank. The same temperature requirements as well. However, unbeknownst to many of these people, their full aquatic experience is limited. So I would recommend looking for the temperature that each fish breeds at, so then you can optimize the fish's health and beauty. However, it generally won't hurt the fish unless they are below or highly above the temperatures of 24 to 30. I would recommend setting the temperature to around 26, 27 for a community tank. Learning water chemistry may seem obvious to many people. Well, at least to me. The first few months, I completely overlooked this. Not only is it comprehending what ammonia, nitrite, and nitrate, and pH are, but more importantly, what you should be learning about the effects of GH and how it affects pH. Why it affects pH, and if its effect is negative or positive. This can help you identify issues within your tank. You can easily diagnose a problem due to the parameters. If your fish has white patches all over it and is very lethargic, this could be many things. But say you test the water and you get an ammonia reading of 0.25 parts per meters, then you can very well call it ammonia burns. Understanding what causes fluctuations in parameters is also vital, so then you can treat or remove the cause. Number 3. Equipment isn't everything. Many people just assume that the hobby is very expensive, which admittedly it can be at times. But if you know your stuff, you can easily work your way around things that are more costly and get them for a better price. This can vary from online shopping for livestock and plants. However, one place that I always go to grab anything I need, whether it be plants, shrimp, guppies, ferts, or food, is Sydney Aquascapes. They are my go-to shop. Their prices are so cheap, yet the products are so quality. So if you live in Australia and you're looking for your number one fish shop, Sydney Aquascapes is definitely the one for you. With shipping starting from just $3, you can save big on all your aquarium products. So just use the link found in the pinned comments below, or use the code NEDSFISHTIPS, all one word, and all lowercase. That's Ned's Fish Tips for up to 20% off store wide. However, many people are also assuming it's very expensive, as much of the equipment that social media influencers use, such as CO2, generally are. However, unbeknownst to many people, especially beginners, things such as CO2 are generally not needed. Generic aquarium lights, when combined with the waste of fish, are usually more than enough to grow and feed aquatic plants. People online, however, use it to grow plants faster. This may be to have fast growth of plants, to show off in an aquascape, or to farm and to sell. Whatever it may be, it's not necessary. All you really need to make the tank is a tank, water, heater and filter, and the fish. You don't even need to have a light. All other components are futile. With that being said, I would class aquatic plants as essential for the plethora of the benefits that they bring. Don't be a perfectionist. In our day-to-day lives, nothing can ever be perfect, or at least for a long enough period. The same thing can be said for the fish-keeping hobby. This, once again, stems from a beginner's perspective watching others on social media such as YouTube. They might watch a video of someone breeding fish. That person breeding those fish will document the whole process and splice it together using editing. What the person, once the video finishes, doesn't completely show is the mistakes. They don't show us the ammonia spike that killed all their fry, nor will they show us the day that they siphoned up the fry. So it's easy for a beginner to see all of their faults, but not others. This isn't having a go at anyone, this is just the effects of other actions presided by people. I, for one, would rather display a short and satisfying process for viewers rather than an unsteady one filled with death. Another way that you can go south about this is if you try to be overly perfect, causing a further and more impactful problem. This one comes about from personal experience. About a year ago, I lost a heap of my Corydoras catfish in my forefoot, and it turns out there was a dip in my water quality. I worked hard to maintain perfect water quality, and I did. But when my pH dropped, I raised it. When it went too high, I dropped it. This was all being done when even with 0.1 parts per meters of the pH changed. Eventually, their constant rise and fall in pH ended up destroying the water quality, as a number of chemicals had been added to stabilize the water and become too high as a result. All of my fish died. Yes, something like a pH drop or increase can be bad, but as long as it's not significant, you shouldn't alter it. This puts significant truth behind the phrase, if it isn't broken, don't fix it. And overall, just generally obsessing can make this hobby turn from something you thoroughly enjoyed into something that feels downright much like work. It can ruin it for you, and it make you disinterested in this amazing hobby. Please buy healthy fish. I know that it may break some people's hearts to go into a pet shop and see a dying or sick fish and think, oh, I have a tank, maybe I can put them in there and save their lives. Despite this being a thoughtful claim, it's often unrealistic. Yes, people can and do this and have done this, but nonetheless, they may be looking just a tad bit sick, but the fish may actually have an underlying health issue or internal disease. One often common example is that a beginner or even an experienced fish keeper walks into a shop and, say, sees a guppy. They buy this guppy in hopes that they can save its life. It only has a bit of fin rot and a couple of ammonia burns, so it is very possible it can be revived. You then go home and place it in your tank. Over the following days, you tend to it, feed it, and do frequent water changes. You believe it begins to get better. One day, you wake up and turn on the tank light, and that guppy is dead. But it was getting better, you thought. And yes, the chances are it was recovering from fin rot, but things such as fin rot and ammonia burns leave the fish's immune system susceptible to underlying health problems. One such example is a parasite. If contracted during this time in the shop and began to die. Although its outer body began to heal, the internal spectrum that the parasite is infecting often leads to its death. It's an overall negative choice to buy them. The fish often die fast, and the disease or parasite may spread to all of your other fish, leaving them fatally ill as well. So it's important to actually try and avoid these fish, so always buy healthy fish. Some great ways to determine if a fish is healthy or not in my three steps are colour. Check for its body and colour and ensure that the patterns are vibrant and not pale, and that they are free of any visual deformities on them. Or loss of colour can indicate sickness or stress that then leads to more sickness. Deformities can also help maintain a strong bloodline if you ever choose to breed your fish. It can also help you pick out which ones have things like scoliosis that progressively develop into the fishes as it grows. The next step is activeness. Test the reaction time of the fish and watch out for lethargic behaviour presented. You can test the reaction time by seeing how long it takes to react to a light knock on the glass, or even the sight of you. Now, you must concur the tank mates. Make sure the rest are healthy, or at least healthy enough that you're confident that they cannot fatally harm the fish and that they are safe to purchase. As I have detailed in previous sections, the majority of key points I'm going to fly through are some other mistakes. One of which is that you need to have plants. Live plants, not plastic ones. As plastic plants can damage your fish's skin and they aren't natural. However, soft, real plants not only can't hurt your fish, but look natural and act as a filter to help remove ammonia from the water. It also adds hiding places. All you need is substrate and a light and they will flourish. For some cheap and hardy plants, please check out the link in the description and use the code NEDSFISHTIPS for checkout 20% off store-wide. You need to ensure that you replicate the fish's natural environment. Yes, most fish in the aquarium trade aren't wild caught and were raised in bare tanks. However, their responses to natural things in their environments are coded into their DNA. By replicating a similar pH, water quality, sometimes even with native plants, it can do a whole lot to your tank and for your fish. These are things that, like lots of plants, such as angelfish or hiding places and driftwood for plecos and shrimp. The list goes on. Number 8. Keep fish tanks in safe spaces. Don't let a tank get too close to a door or a frequently used part of your house, as one day when you're in a rush or one day when some kids are mucking around, not only would it spell disaster for your carpet or wooden floor, but your fish will most likely be killed, as the wooden door will be swung open, smashed into the fish tank, or kids will be mucking around and run into it and glass and water will go everywhere. On a similar note, don't let inexperienced people care and handle your fish. Say you go on a holiday and get someone to feed your fish and you give them a vague answer of a pinch is what they'll be fed for the fish. Most individuals will accidentally put too much or too little and this can spell disaster as it leads to an ammonia spike. Although it may be tempting, especially with monster fish like large cichlids and flower horns, please, please, please do not feed them captured animals such as mice or cockroaches. I have seen way too many videos of people online catching live mice infested with God knows what and feeding it to their fish. Not only is this not part of their diet in the wild, but obviously mice carry many diseases. The same thing can be said for bugs like cockroaches and crickets being fed to axolotls who are especially delicate. All in all, it's just a bad idea as these diseases can end up stuffing your tank, and it's definitely not what you want. Please don't run the risk and just feed the fish the proper food that they deserve. All in all, keeping fish is an extremely rewarding hobby. However, at times, both inexperienced and experienced fish keepers alike make some mistakes. Some severe and others not so much. So just make sure to look out for my listed mistakes to protect your fish. The comment of the video goes out to New York Gold. So leave a comment down below for your chances to shout out next video. If you want to support me, please check out the pinned comment and I'll see you all in the next one. Stay safe. Bye.